माय वॉइस इज क्लियर राइट?
या
आई विल टुडे आई विल टॉक अबाउट रैंडम वॉक्स ऑन ग्राफ्स. सो फार यू हैव बीन सीइंग समथिंग रिलेटेड टू स्पेक्ट्रल ग्राफ थ्योरी एंड आई विल कंटिन्यू ऑन दीज लाइंस एंड दिस इज अ स्लाइटली अप्लाइड पार्ट ऑफ इट सो टू से.
One request, madam.
Yes.
Can you please keep it horizontal so that we can see it?
Yeah, properly. Landscape mode will be much more useful.
Is this yeah. better?
Yes. Okay. Yes.
Yes, madam. Thank you.
Okay. So I have not made complete notes because I thought if I just flash the calculations, it will not be very comprehensible. So some parts I will write as I go on. But the basic things I have written a priori. Later on, I will be writing whatever I need to calculate. Okay. So we will be looking at undirected graphs. So our graph will be G, vertex set V and edge set E. And we will always work with finite graphs. So let's say the graph has n vertices, we will number them from 1 to n. And just to recall, the adjacency matrix of a graph is an n cross n matrix. So A is n cross n. And the ijth entry is 1 if the edge ij is in the set E and otherwise the entry is 0. So we all have seen the adjacency matrix. We will also be interested in another matrix, the Laplacian matrix, which is defined as D minus A. So here, A is again the adjacency matrix. D is the diagonal matrix with degrees of the vertices along the diagonal. So the iith entry of D is the degree of vertex I, whereas the ijth entry is 0 whenever I is not equal to 0. So how does the Laplacian matrix look like? Diagonal entries of the Laplacian are degrees of the vertices. The iith entry is degree of vertex I. Whereas the off diagonal entries, ij, I not equal to j, they are either minus 1 provided that edge is present in the graph and otherwise the entry is 0. So Laplacian looks like this. So this is the degree of vertex 1 up to degree of vertex n. And there are some minus ones whenever there are edges and zeros otherwise. And it is a symmetric matrix because we have an undirected graph. So whenever ij is an edge, ji is also an edge. So this Laplacian has several nice properties. And we will go over them. Sorry if it is a repetition from previous talks. I tried to avoid it as much as possible, but it is better to lay down the notation and terms once and for all. So first of all, if we look at this Laplacian matrix and consider the product of this Laplacian with a real vector, suppose LV is W, this is the kind of product we are looking at. So W is also obviously a real vector, both in Rn. And the ith entry of W will look like the degree of the vertex I times the ith entry of V. This comes because of the diagonal entry. And minus this, whatever are the neighbors of the vertex I, the jth entry of the V vector. So this is how the W vector will look like. And because we have this degree I times VI here, we can split it into VI plus VI plus VI. Degree many times. This degree of I many times. And each of them we can pair up with Vj. So we get a sum over all the edges which are incident on I, Vi minus Vj. Okay, and what we will be interested in is actually the Rayleigh quotient V transpose LV. So we have seen what L times V is. The ith entry of L times V is just So sum over all neighbors of I, sum over all j, which are neighbors of I, vi minus vj. Now, another v transpose when we multiply with the above vector, we get this ith entry of v again because of the v transpose, and this term as it is from here. So this takes a nice form, that is, we can combine these two summations. So the sum becomes over all edges. So we go over all edges ij, vi times vi minus vj. But then the same term also appears for j. So corresponding to every vi times vi minus vj term, there is also a term vj times vj minus vi, because the graph is undirected and the matrix is symmetric. So there is a corresponding term like this. Now this, of course, we can make minus here and plus here and take out the minus. So we get over all edges vi minus vj whole squared. So this is the Rayleigh quotient of the Laplacian. Now the nice thing about this particular form is we see that it is a sum of squares. So this cannot be negative, which means all the eigenvalues of this Laplacian matrix will be more than equal to zero. They will be non-negative. And another thing is, if we imagine that this vector v denotes the positioning of the vertices of the graph on the number line, that is, we put ith vertex at position vi, then v transpose lv is the, so vi minus vj is the length of the ij edge when the vertices are placed on a line like this. V1 somewhere, there will be V2 and V3 and so on. So this will be the length of the edge ij. And we will have the Rayleigh quotient to be the sum of squares of the lengths of all the edges. Okay, so the smaller eigenvectors, that is eigenvectors corresponding to small eigenvalues, they will try to put the vertices close together on the number line, whereas eigenvectors corresponding to large eigenvalues, they will try to spread out the vertices as much as possible on the number line. So we will be interested in the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of the Laplacian matrix. I will call the eigenvalues as mu1 to mu n, and I will also assume that they are ordered in non-decreasing order. So few simple observations about this Laplacian matrix are like this. First of all, it is real and symmetric. So the eigenvalues are all real. And also all eigenvectors are orthogonal to each other. And then because of this quadratic form that we got, the Laplacian Rayleigh quotient we could express as this sum of squares. So all the eigenvalues are non-negative. So we get mu1 to mu n are all more than equal to zero. Next thing to observe is that the smallest eigenvalue is always zero. Right? Because if we look at the first entry, for example, there is degree of vertex one here, and as many minus ones as the degree. There will be some zeros in between, but there will be as many minus ones as the degree of this vertex. So whenever we multiply with a vector which consists of all ones, the product becomes zero. Okay, so if I make that all ones vector into a unit vector, I get the vector 1 over root n everywhere. This is a n cross 1 vector. And this becomes the eigenvector which corresponds to eigenvalue 0. Because when we take L times V, we get 0. So, am I making sense, or do you have any questions or comments?
No, ma'am. For any matrix whose row sum is 0.
Sorry?
The same proof works, whether works or not, for the matrix whose row sum is zero. every row sum.
Yes, if all the rows sum to zero, then the all ones vector will be an eigenvector corresponding to eigenvalue zero.
Same theorem works for such type of matrices.
Yes, so if all the row sums are zero, then if we multiply with all ones vector, then the row, it will just, I mean, every such row multiplied with the all ones vector will give us zero.
Okay.
Here we are not using anything about anything else about Laplacian except that all the rows sum to zero. And in fact, all
the specialty we are using here of Laplacian matrix. That is my question.
For saying that there is eigenvalue, I mean, zero is an eigenvalue of the Laplacian, all we need is the row sum being zero.
Okay, ma'am.
And why it is the smallest eigenvalue and why all the eigenvalues are non-negative? There we need that quadratic form, which is specific to the Laplacian. So for some other matrix, zero may not be the smallest eigenvalue. There might be negative eigenvalues as well. Or even if the matrix is not symmetric, then even there will be complex eigenvalues. But what makes the eigenvalues all real and non-negative? That is the special structure of the Laplacian, which was the quadratic form that we saw. So this vector, which has the same entry everywhere, that is all ones vector, that is an eigenvector which corresponds to eigenvalue zero. And now we will see one more thing about in the context of eigenvalues. That is, we said that mu one is less than equal to mu two and so on up to mu n. So can mu two be zero? So here is a result which says that the multiplicity of the zero eigenvalue is in fact the number of connected components in G. So if the graph is connected, that is it has only one connected component, then mu2 is certainly non-zero. And if the graph has in general k connected components, then certainly the first k eigenvalues are zero. Do I need to define connected components?
No, we know connected.
No, madam, it's okay.
Oh. Okay. So I will show this a little bit. So here, suppose the graph has k connected components S1 to SK. Then we will exhibit k eigenvectors which correspond to eigenvalue 0 and they are orthogonal to each other. So they cannot be the there is no linear dependence among them. So if there are these k connected components, the Laplacian would have a block diagonal structure. This corresponds to one connected component and this corresponds to finally the k connected component. So there will be a block structure like this to the Laplacian. Within S1, it will act like a graph on its own. So this is like putting k different graphs together. So the Laplacian will also look like putting k different Laplacians together. Okay, and the k eigenvectors would be, we can put a one corresponding to all the positions in S1 and zeros elsewhere. Okay, so since others are anyway zero, here we will have, every row of that S1 part will multiply to this vector and bring a zero, because again, the row sum is zero. And these are all zeros. So these are zeros everywhere except these blocks. So if the graph is not connected, if it has multiple connected components, we get this kind of block structure. We can treat each of these connected components as a separate graph, take its Laplacian, and put all these Laplacians in this fashion along the, in a block diagonal fashion, and make the Laplacian for the whole graph. And then the eigenvectors will be again of this form, that is, the one first eigenvector will be one at positions corresponding to S1. The second eigenvector will be zero here corresponding to the positions in S2 or the vertices in S2, it will be 1. This will correspond to S2. And we can do this for all the k of them. Okay, and see that this vector is orthogonal to this vector because they don't have a common non-zero entry anywhere. Whenever the first vector is 1, at all those places the second vector is 0 and vice versa. So when we take their inner products, that inner product is going to be 0. So if I call this vector as u1, this vector as u2, we can construct all these u3 to uk in a similar fashion, where the uith vector will have 1s corresponding to the vertices which appear in the ith connected component and 0s elsewhere. And each of these ui, uj inner products are 0 because their non-zero entries don't match anymore. And of course, we have that L times U1 up to L times UK, they are all 0. Sorry, I called them V's here. Okay. It's okay. I will call them V instead of U. These are the V1 to Vk vectors. So L times Vi is 0. Vi inner product Vj is also 0 whenever I is not equal to j. And we can make them all unit vectors by appropriate scaling. So this we need by appropriate scaling. That is, we need this, instead of 1, we need to put 1 over square root of the size of ith component. Now, the converse I will only sketch. I will not go into rigorous proof because then we can't cover the later parts. Once again, look at the Rayleigh quotient of the Laplacian. We have this quadratic form, that is Vi minus Vj whole square summed over all edges ij. Now, if this Vi, a particular Vi, I keep as a non-constant. Non-zero. Then this whole thing cannot become zero because we have all squares. So nothing here can cancel each other. Each Vi minus Vj squared term is actually non-negative. So if we put all of them, even if one of those terms is non-zero, the whole Rayleigh quotient is going to be non-zero. In other words, if the Rayleigh quotient has to be zero, that is, okay, what we are trying to prove is, suppose the graph has a single connected component, then the multiplicity of the eigenvalue zero is only one. We saw that all ones vector is an eigenvector that corresponds to eigenvalue 0. So certainly 0 is an eigenvalue. I am trying to show that there cannot be more eigenvalues with value 0. Okay, so one eigenvector that corresponds to eigenvalue 0 is this all ones. If the 0 eigenvalue has multiplicity more than 1, then I need to exhibit another vector which is orthogonal to this one and still gives Rayleigh quotient 0. But that cannot happen because the orthogonal vector has to have something which is different from all ones. In fact, it has to have positive and negative entries. And these terms cannot cancel each other. So whenever I put something which is non-zero and Vi is different from Vj, even for one edge, if I put Vi and Vj to be different, then this Vi minus Vj squared contributes a positive quantity, which cannot be cancelled by other terms because they are also not going to be negative. So this Rayleigh quotient can be zero only if our vector v is constant on every connected component. Please let me know if there is any question, if I'm not being clear enough or rigorous enough.
No, it's going quite well.
Oh, thank you. Okay, so now we know that the eigenvalue of the, multiplicity of the eigenvalue zero of the Laplacian tells us the number of connected components in the graph. Now, in the rest of this talk, we will consider only D regular graphs, that is, degree of every vertex is D. The degree of I is D for I in 1 to n. So I have not written down things now. I will write it now as I go. Okay. So the second eigenvalue tells us about the number of connected components. The second eigenvalue tells us about whether the graph is connected or not. Because if it is zero, the graph is not connected. If it is non-zero, certainly the graph is connected. But we actually that eigenvalue gives more information than this. So that we will see how. So to do that, let me just give this heading that we want to relate connectivity and second eigenvalue mu 2. So what do we mean by the amount of connectivity? Or once the graph is connected, how do we measure the extent to which it is connected? Of course, what I mean here is some graphs are more well connected than some other graphs. Right? So there might be a graph like this, where if this edge is removed, the graph gets disconnected. Whereas there can be a densely connected graph, which doesn't get disconnected unless we remove many edges. So this is the kind of connectivity that we are talking about here. But to make it formal, I will define the edge expansion for a vertex set. Consider a subset of vertices S. The edge expansion is defined as pi of S. I will call it pi of S. This is the number of edges which go from S to V minus S, and divided by d times the size of this. Remember that d is the degree of each vertex. So what is the intuition behind defining this edge expansion? For the set S, because the graph is d-regular, the vertices in S together have the number of edges incident on vertices in the set S. They are mod S times B. Of course, every edge might be counted twice here because an edge might have both endpoints in S. But the sum of degrees is mod S times B. So this edge expansion measures the fraction of these number of edges which are actually being used for connecting S to the rest of the graph. Okay, so if all the edges of S connect S to the rest of the graph, this pi S will be 1. And otherwise, if the S is a separate connected component and there are no edges going out of S to V minus S, then this pi S will be 0. So always pi S lies between 0 and 1. Okay, so this edge expansion tells how well connected the set S is to the rest of the graph. Now this kind of connectivity plays a big role in networks, because if I have several servers and I want to connect the servers among themselves, of course I can make it a complete graph, but then making it a complete graph involves spending a lot on the connection, because between every pair of servers I need a direct connection. So that makes things expensive. Whereas I don't want the connections so that one link fails and my network gets disconnected. So this is there is a trade-off between the number of edges that we are willing to put in versus the connectivity. And that is where this edge expansion plays a role. And it tells us how well connected any set is to the rest of the graph. So for a graph G, we define again the edge expansion. For this graph G, edge expansion is just minimum over all the sets. Minimum over S, zero, we don't want S to be empty. So zero strictly less than mod S, and at most mod V over two, like edge expansion of S. So among all the subsets of vertices, we look at the one which has minimum edge expansion, and that we define as the edge expansion of the graph.
I have a question. Basically, why do you need regularity? You want the graph to be regular, right? So why regularity is important here, or is there any specific reason?
Actually, for this particular definition, we don't need regularity. I will just relate this edge expansion to the second eigenvalue of the Laplacian. And there, that particular expression is there when the graph is regular.
Okay.
So I will write that expression now, although I will not prove it because we need to look at some other things. But indeed, this is an important inequality which relates the second eigenvalue of the Laplacian with the connectivity or edge expansion of the graph. And that expression just becomes simpler if it is a deregular graph.
Okay.
I said that second eigenvalue of the Laplacian. Second means second smallest. This was mu 2. I will define a different, not different, but a scaled version of Laplacian, let's say this script L. So Laplacian was D minus A, where D is the diagonal matrix. This I will define as identity minus 1 over D times the adjacency matrix. So just to compare, this earlier Laplacian that I defined was D minus A. This is just a scaled version of it, scaled by a factor of 1 over D. So here, the eigenvalue was 0. Here also it will remain 0. But in general, between this L and this L, the eigenvalues will just scale by a 1 over D factor. So the eigenvalue of this Laplacian was mu 2. Let me call this one as, say, mu 2 prime. I could have written it as mu 2 over D as well, but I will just give a different name. Okay, so this L is called as normalized Laplacian. And what relates this mu 2 prime with the edge expansion is the Strigger's inequality, which is this mu 2 prime over 2 is less than or equal to the edge expansion of the graph, which is less than or equal to square root of 2 times mu 2 prime. So all I want to point out here is that the connectivity, or how well connected different subsets of vertices of a graph are with other vertices, that is denoted by the edge expansion, which in turn is related to this second eigenvalue of the Laplacian. There isn't much difference between the normalized Laplacian and the ordinary Laplacian, at least for deregular graphs, because it's just a 1 over D scaling factor. So in particular, if we can prove that the second eigenvalue is relatively large, it is not very close to zero, then that also tells us that the edge expansion of the graph is good. So for example, if the second eigenvalue is say 1/4, then we can say that at least the 1/8 fraction of edges incident on every set are used for connecting that set to the remaining vertices. Okay, so this edge expansion and construction of such graphs which have a good edge expansion, that I will talk more about in the next talk. But today I will talk about another application of this second eigenvalue and eigenvector. Any comments so far? So what we want to consider today are random walks on graphs. So what is a random walk? As the name suggests, if we are given a graph, a random walk just involves starting from any vertex, let's say this. I have not drawn a regular graph, but you will be interested in the random walk on a regular graph, not necessarily complete. So we start from a vertex and we randomly choose one of its neighbors when uniformly at random. So out of the neighbors of this vertex, we will go to one of the neighbors with probability 1/d. So from here, suppose we go here. So this is the step one. This is our step two. And we will continue this procedure. So even at the second vertex that we are at, we will again choose one of its neighbors uniformly at random and go to that vertex. So why are we doing this? One thing that we want to know is how many steps are necessary to visit all the vertices of the graph in this fashion. Of course, we cannot give a deterministic answer here. There will always be some error probability. We want that error probability to be small. Okay, so the question is, if we just keep on hopping from one vertex to another, picking the next neighbor uniformly at random among all neighbors of that vertex, do we end up visiting all the vertices with some good probability? So this is important from an algorithmic perspective. It is also important from statistical viewpoint, but we will go to that later. So from algorithmic perspective, if to determine in general if a graph is connected, one needs to perform some kind of a search algorithm on a graph. And one has to keep remembering what vertices have been visited in past. So the typical depth first or breadth first search procedures, they determine whether a graph is connected or not, but they also need space which is space as much as large as n. Whereas if the graph is very large, this procedure gives, it doesn't involve remembering anything. You just come to a vertex, pick a neighbor uniformly at random and go there, and you can forget about where you came from. So algorithmically, this gives a very, very space efficient algorithm, a randomized one for determining whether the graph is connected. One might think that what is a guarantee that we will visit all vertices? We might keep oscillating between the same small set of vertices. That probability is very small, and as we perform more and more number of steps like this, that probability goes to zero. So that is one view of the random walk. Shall I write it down? Start at any vertex, say I. And pick one of its neighbors uniformly at random. say J. And perform the same procedure from J. And so on. So we keep on hopping from one vertex to another, and we will see that as the number of hops increases, we are very likely to visit all the vertices, or the probability that we will still miss a vertex goes close to zero. It approaches zero. So another view is we start with some initial probability distribution, and start with a probability distribution P on vertices. On the whole vertex set. So earlier when we started from a particular vertex I, our P looked like zero everywhere and only the one was in the ith place. This distribution is also fine. After all, this is also a probability distribution. So we start with any probability distribution P on V. And what is the distribution on the vertex set that we get after one step of our random walk? Where the one step is performed as before, as I showed earlier. After one step, our probability distribution becomes I did not define this particular matrix. I will define. Okay, let me just define this first. Sorry. So, okay, how do we perform these random walks? So, after one step, the probability distribution changes to something. I will write the expression after I define the necessary matrix. Okay, and as we perform more and more steps of the random walk, this probability distribution, or what does that distribution tell? What is the probability that we are at a particular vertex after certain number of steps? So the distribution after ith step tells us what is the probability that we are in a particular vertex. And we are interested in knowing when or after how many steps is this distribution close to the uniform one. So our starting probability distribution could be as skewed as this one. But what we want is that after we perform more and more number of steps of this walk, we want to go close to the uniform distribution of all the vertices. This is what is called as mixing in the Markov chain literature. Okay, so this random walk is also seen as this distribution that we start with, eventually it will converge to the uniform distribution. So if the concept is not clear, or you have any comments, please tell. I will make it precise and define things.
So for this graph from one vertex to other vertex, adjacent vertex, probability will be 1 by 4, no?
Yes. So with probability 1 by 4, we will go to one of its neighbors. And
then we can continue for, again, adjacent vertices for that specific second vertex.
Yes. So for example, if this is the vertex we end up choosing with probability 1/4, of course, then from this, we will again do the same procedure.
Again, just multiply by 1 by 4 and 1 by 4, I think.
Yes, this procedure we will keep doing. And we want to show that eventually this distribution converges to the uniform distribution. Of course, the graph I have drawn is a complete one. It need not be complete.
Yes, regularity. Why regularity is needed then?
No, just for the sake of analysis. It is not that it won't converge on the But like the whole calculation becomes simpler, and instead of dealing with the intricacies of non-regularity, if I just stick to regular graphs, the crux of the random walk is put forth in a better way.
Okay.
So it is not that it doesn't work on non-regular graphs. That is not. But see, regular graphs can also be not very well connected, right? I might have a graph like this. So this, I'm going to make this graph three regular. And maybe something here. Okay, so this graph is not very well connected because there is a cut in this graph of size 2. Although it is a regular graph, it need not be very well connected. And on such graphs, actually the probability of going from one part to another part, if there are few edges, that probability will be small. Such graphs will take longer to converge to uniform distribution. So we will quantify this.
So can one say that the constant that you defined is small in this case?
In this case, that edge expansion will be small because corresponding to...
Right.
Yeah, corresponding to this vertex set, out of the 12 edges that these vertices have incident on them, only 2 are going out. So it will be precisely 2 over 12. This is a small size graph, but for a large graph, it can be quite bad. For an n vertex graph, it can be something like 1 over n kind of. Okay, so to analyze this random walk, we again look at the adjacency matrix. And remember that for regular graphs, it doesn't make much difference whether we use the adjacency matrix or the Laplacian matrix, because they are just related by that subtraction with the regular deregular diagonal matrix D. So we will again use the adjacency matrix, but because we are now talking about probabilities, we will scale that matrix. Okay, so adjacency matrix is A. We will define a scaled adjacency matrix. This is M, and this I will define as ij entry to be 1 over D if ij is an edge. Okay, so the ij entry of M is 1 over D if ij is an edge and 0 otherwise. So instead of the 0, 1 entries in the adjacency matrix, we will use 0 versus 1 over D entries. Why? Because then every row and every column will sum to 1. And this matrix will be useful in our random walk analysis. So the scaled adjacency matrix, its eigenvalues will also be scaled. A few things to quickly observe is that all row sums and column sums of this matrix are 1. And because the sums are 1, we also have that the largest eigenvalue of this matrix is 1. Again, what is the corresponding eigenvector? If we look at this matrix M, which has 1 over D in some places, in fact, exactly D many places and zeros elsewhere, and we multiply with all ones vector, this will give us all ones vector back. Okay, so I will denote this all ones vector as the vector notation with 1. This is an eigenvector corresponding to eigenvalue 1. This is the largest one for it. For the initial Laplacian, it was 0. For the adjacency matrix, it becomes D minus 0, that is D, where D is the degree of that deregular graph. Here, again, a 1 over D scaling happens, and the largest eigenvalue becomes 1. So, the importance of using this matrix instead of the Laplacian will be clear in a moment. Okay, so our step 0, that is the initial step, we have the probability distribution P. At step one, we can say that this probability distribution is it will just be M times P. Especially P is the P is the vector here of this kind, then the ith row of M will only multiply. Any row of M when you multiply with this vector P, for those rows which correspond to the neighbors of the vertex I, it will contribute a 1 over D entry. For everything else, it will be 0. So in particular, if we take M times this one, where the 1 is only in the ith place, then the resulting vector has zeros and 1 over D entries, where these 1 over D entries correspond to neighbors of I. Okay, so M times this vector gives us a vector which is uniform on the neighbors of I and zeros elsewhere. This is how anyway we have defined our random walk, because starting from the vertex I, we will uniformly pick one of its neighbors. So in general, after T steps of this walk, what will we have? The distribution will be M raised to T times P. And our goal here now in the remaining part is to analyze the distance of this distribution from uniform. How do we measure the distance of two distributions? We measure them as L2 norm of their difference. So M raised to T times P minus the uniform distribution vector, the L2 norm of this. So is the goal clear? We will, intuitively we expect that as we perform more and more steps of this kind of walk, our distribution will be closer and closer to uniform. Here we will be quantifying it in terms of the number of steps.
Is it 1 bar or 1 bar by D? The uniform, the uniform distribution?
Yes.
It's 1 bar or 1 bar by D?
Yes, so I will just, I used it just for the sake of simplicity, but yes, we will now redefine this 1 bar, which will be 1 over n everywhere. Since these are the, this is the same all ones vector, but with a scaled version, I used the same notation, but yes, now here onwards, we will call it the uniform distribution vector, and we will assume that it is 1 over n everywhere. Our P is also a vector, although I did not put the vector notation. Okay, so the precise theorem that we will prove is that the norm of this M raised to T times P minus the uniform distribution vector is bounded by, I will write, and then the second eigenvalue raised to T. Here, let me tell what the second eigenvalue is. So lambda 2 here is the second largest eigenvalue of the matrix M. So because we had L equal to D minus A, each eigen, I mean the ith eigenvalue of L is D minus the N minus ith eigenvalue of A. So the eigenvalues correspond in a reverse order. So if we arrange the eigenvalues of the Laplacian in increasing order, that amounts to arranging the eigenvalues of the adjacency matrix in the decreasing order with a subtraction from subtracted from D. So the eigenvalues to each other very simply. The smallest eigenvalue of Laplacian is zero, which means using this that the largest eigenvalue of the adjacency matrix is D. Similarly, the largest eigenvalue of this A matrix is 1 because that is A scaled with D. And whatever status the second smallest eigenvalue of Laplacian has, the same status here is there for the second largest eigenvalue of this matrix A or M. Okay, so because the second largest eigenvalue of the adjacency matrix A is just D minus the second smallest eigenvalue of the Laplacian. So essentially they are the same in terms of the role that they play. Okay, so here we will see that as long as this eigenvalue lambda 2 is strictly smaller than 1, this lambda 2 raised to t will be going to 0 as t increases, or as t tends to infinity. If there is any question or comment, I will take. Otherwise, I will prove this theorem. Okay, so let's look at the proof. So this matrix M that we are considering, which is the scaled adjacency matrix or normalized adjacency matrix as it is called. This is again a real symmetric matrix with all real eigenvalues, and we also saw how they relate to the Laplacian eigenvalues in fact. And okay, before we proceed, I will also do one more thing, that is we will put a self loop on each vertex. Why is it important to put a self loop? Because otherwise, if the graph is bipartite, our distribution will never converge to uniform. In the odd number of steps, our walk will deterministically be in one bipartition. In the even number of steps, it will be in second bipartition. So just to break that, we are putting a self loop on each vertex that doesn't harm the deregularity of the graph. It will increase a degree by 1, we will call D as D plus 1. Okay, so with this change now, we can prove this theorem. Is the role of self loop clear? If at all the graph happens to be bipartite, we will never get the convergence to uniform without this self loop. Okay, so again, suppose V1 to Vn be the eigenvectors of the matrix M. And they span whole of Rn because M is a real symmetric matrix. So they form an orthogonal basis to Rn. Hence, we can express this probability distribution P that we started with as a linear combination of these eigenvectors. So suppose the coefficients are alpha i's. So I can express P as sum over alpha I times Vi. So this is a linear combination. Now again note that we will take this v1 to be the uniform distribution vector. It is not a unit vector. We will use its magnitude for scaling whenever required. One more thing we will observe here now. We will take the inner product of this distribution P with the uniform distribution vector. Now observe here that these v1 to vn are mutually orthogonal. Because M is the real symmetric matrix. So inner product of this uniform distribution vector with all v2 to vn is going to be zero. So what we will be left with here is just alpha 1 times the inner product of 1 with itself. V1 is also 1. So we can write alpha 1 as just inner product of P with the all ones vector divided by all ones, I mean, sorry, the uniform distribution vector divided by the uniform distribution vector squared. Okay, so this one will be again this 1 over n vector everywhere. So then because P is also a probability distribution, all entries of P sum to 1 and all of them are in fact non-negative. So we will get this numerator also as 1 over n and the denominator is also 1 over n. So this alpha 1 will turn out to be 1. So we can in fact express P as 1. This is actually number, the uniform distribution vector 1 plus the linear combination of the remaining vectors, alpha I times pi. Now we will look at the distribution that we get after t many steps. So m raised to t times p. That just amounts to multiplying everything with m raised to t. M raised to t times all ones. That is the uniform distribution plus I equal to 2 to n alpha I. Alpha I is a scalar, of course, because this is a linear combination. And m raised to t times vi. But again, m has all rows summing to 1. So because this 1 is also a uniform distribution vector, m raised to t times 1 will be simply 1. And m raised to t times vi is lambda I times vi, because vi is the eigenvector corresponding to the ith eigenvalue. We call it lambda I. Okay, so this will be I equal to 2 to n alpha. Sorry, there is a t factor here. Alpha I lambda I raised to t times vi. And now that we have this m raised to t times p here and the uniform distribution vector here, we are in a position to bring them together and calculate their L2 norm. M raised to t times p minus 1, and we take norm here, but the squared L2 norm. This also amounts to taking the squared L2 norm on the other side. I'm just writing it as it is. And the second, that is the RHS, we will bound to be lambda 2 raised to t. Please stop me if you point in some, I mean, you notice something which is not clear or not correct. So how do we analyze this? First of all, because the VIs are mutually orthogonal, when we expand this norm, any VI times VJ where I is not equal to J will turn out to be 0. So we are in fact left with just the summation, because we are taking squares, alpha I square, every lambda I raised to 2t now, and the norm of V I square. Now we have arranged the eigenvalues as lambda 1 more than equal to lambda 2 and so on. But this largest eigenvalue is 1. We are concerned about the second largest eigenvalue, lambda 2. So in fact, lambda 2 forms an upper bound on all remaining eigenvalues. So we can write this as lambda 2 raised to 2t, that is this every lambda I we replace with lambda 2 and we get a less than equal to here. So this lambda 2 raised to 2t times I equal to 2 to n alpha I square, again norm of V I square. But see, this was a part of, this actually expressed P. The linear combination expressed P when we had this uniform distribution vector in it. But the uniform distribution vector was anyway contributing a positive quantity. We can also bound this as, we can bound this by L2 norm of P. So this thing I will bound as lambda 2 raised to 2 T times L2 square L2 norm of P. We are almost done. We are reaching that lambda 2 raised to t bound that we had. And I will just complete this and then. Now, what do we do this with this norm of p or squared norm of p? So, p is a probability vector. Hence, all the entries are between any ith entry of p belongs to 0, 0, 1 interval. So, this L2 squared norm of p is actually upper bounded by the one norm of p. Because whenever we square the entries of p, if the entry of p is 0, it is going to remain 0. If it is anything other than 0, if it is 1, it is going to remain 1 when we take the square. If it is anything intermediate, its value is only going to go down when we take square. So we can safely replace the two norm by one norm. But then what is one norm of p? It is just sum of entries of the vector p. And because it's a probability distribution, the entries are going to sum to 1. So this is just equal to lambda 2 raised to 2t. So here also we had a square. We take square roots on both sides, we will get m raised to t times our probability distribution minus the uniform distribution. L2 norm of this is bounded by lambda 2 raised to t, and this will be positive because we are looking at norm. So what is the significance of this whole thing? If lambda 2 is actually quite small, anyway, largest one, lambda 1 is going to be 1. If lambda 2 is quite small, much smaller than 1, then on such a graph, this random walk will quickly converge to uniform distribution. So smaller is the lambda 2 value, faster is the convergence to uniform distribution of our random walk. So what have we seen? We saw that the edge expansion or the extent of connectivity in a slightly informal sense of a graph relates to the second eigenvalue. I am saying second because it is the second smallest for Laplacian and second largest for the adjacent symmetrix. So the second eigenvalue. And in turn, we expect that if the graph is better connected, then a random walk on it should converge quickly to uniform distribution, which is quantified by this relation that we have seen. If there is any question or comment, I will take it. Otherwise, there is a small thing left which I will cover now and then we'll stop.
Excuse me, madam.
Yes.
I'm not that much familiar with statistics, but when you say this converges to uniform distribution, means what is it in layman's words?
Sorry, can you repeat the last part? When it converges to uniform distribution?
This distribution converges to uniform distribution means what actually happens there, or what, how one can see?
Yes. So, see, the initial vector that we started with, the probability vector, by the way, we need not start with anything in particular. Whatever probability vector we take, that is fine. In particular, we took this one, where we start from ith vertex. Okay, so, the rest of the entries are zero, which means we started with probability one for ith vertex and zeros elsewhere. Now, as we perform more and more steps of this random walk, the question is, what is the probability of being in a particular, at a particular vertex after t number of steps? Okay, so at the beginning, the probability of being anywhere else other than I was zero. After one step, the probability of being in one of the neighbors of I, that was 1 over d, and everywhere else it was zero. But what we are saying is, after we perform t many steps, where t is something large, which we have still not quantified, but as we perform more and more number of steps, we can be as likely to be at any vertex as any other vertex.
In short, after a long time, probability will be equal. I think
that will only happen at infinity, right? Because this is not going to be zero, lambda 2 raised to t.
Almost equal, means near about.
Yes.
So every vertex, you can be at any vertex. That is what that means.
Yes. And the significance of this being at any vertex with the same probability, that comes from the first view of random walk that we took. That is, if I start blindly walking from one vertex to another, by just picking a random neighbor at every step, I am quite likely to visit all the vertices of the graph. So algorithmically, this is useful in large graphs because I don't have to remember what all vertices I have visited in past. I need to spend some memory for that and also some lookup time, right? Sorry, were you saying something?
Thank you.
Okay. So again, if we have a very large graph, this is not large, but this is not deregular either, but let's pretend that this is deregular. So how do we otherwise determine whether this graph is connected or not? We have this depth first or breadth first search algorithms. If you don't know this, there is no problem with this. What all I am trying to say is, the typical algorithms which determine whether a graph is connected or not, they actually keep visiting vertices and keep remembering where we came from. So such an algorithm will visit this vertex one, deterministically go to one of its neighbors. Let's call this one as two. And suppose the third step, it goes to three. Now it will pick one of the neighbors of three, but that if that neighbor happens to be one, it will have this visited neighbor stored somewhere. So visited vertices stored somewhere. So such algorithm every time has to go and check whether this neighbor is visited or not. So when it reaches here somehow, so we came from 1 to 2, 2 to 3. From 3, suppose we come here. And from this, or let's say we come here after that. Now, if the algorithm tries to go again to the vertex 2, because it is one of the neighbors of this vertex, that such an algorithm will not do, because it will also keep looking up into this thing, this table. So any algorithm which determines connectivity in a deterministic fashion, it has to remember what all vertices it has visited. in today's world, when there are large graphs arising in many places, like a large network of servers, or let's say Facebook kind of companies keep track of who is connected to whom. So there are like millions of people, and an algorithm doesn't want to remember, or can't even afford to remember what all vertices have been seen earlier. So there, this kind of algorithm actually provides a very space efficient way, although it is a bit randomized and has some small error probability. That error probability is vanishingly small as more number of steps are performed. So the advantage of such an algorithm is that you just go from current vertex to one of the uniform neighbors and don't remember anything. Okay, so what this random walk practically offers is a space efficient algorithm to determine whether the graph is connected.
Do you mean to say that if the distribution to which it converges is uniform, then it is connected graph? Is that what you're saying?
Yes, because if it is not connected, then whichever connected component you start from, you will never end up going to another connected component.
But then do you not have to visit each and every vertex if you allow the allow the person to say visit vertices randomly? I mean, how long? So you mean you want to compute this matrix and then apply it on a particular probability distribution and then see how rapidly it converges, and then you conclude that it is, I mean, I don't understand how exactly it is detecting connectedness.
Yes, I will come to that. One second.
I have one question in tune with the Ganesh sir's question. How will you determine that all vertices are exhausted in some sense?
So that is the same question.
Yeah.
So typically, such an algorithm, more than connectivity, just wants to check if you can go to vertex J from vertex I. So the questions that this algorithm can answer is there a path from J, I to J?
Both I, J are arbitrary.
Yes. So given two vertices, if you actually perform some kind of deterministic algorithm, then you have to remember all the vertices which you encounter in your search. Whereas here, you just start walking from I, and this assures this what we have proved just now. It assures us that we will end up visiting J with considerably large probability as we perform certain number of steps of this walk. Coming to, I think Ganesh sir asked this. So if I said uniform distribution and so on, and like this difference can become arbitrarily small only if the graph is connected. If the graph is not connected, and it has say two connected components, S1 and S2. If we start from some vertex in S1, this random walk will never go to S2. So it will achieve a uniform distribution on this. But it will never have any non-zero probability on S2. Right? So some entries of that probability vector m^2t times p have to remain zero if the graph is not connected.
So it cannot be less than some value.
Yes, but in that case, we also know that the second eigenvalue will also have value 1. So if the graph is not connected, this lambda 2 is 1, just like the Laplacian eigenvalue second one is 0. So correspondingly, this lambda 2 will be 1. And in that case, the only guarantee we get is that our distribution and uniform distribution have difference 1, which doesn't make any sense because anyway both are probability distributions. Their difference cannot be large.
So basically, this is for infinitely many infinite graph or large graphs.
Say it again, sorry.
So this is actually for processes for large graphs.
Yes. Because I mean, for large graphs, we actually want such a process because we don't want to spend space in remembering what all vertices we visited. Okay, so if G is connected.
Ma'am, there is a query here.
Yes.
So as this is a randomized algorithm, so suppose we are concluding that the graph is connected. So what is the error probability? What are the chances that my decision is wrong?
So the error probability will again be in terms of this lambda 2.
But how I'll be seeing my that case? I mean, if suppose I want to do the error analysis over this, how I'll be analyzing that case? That in what under what condition I'm saying that my decision is wrong? Because what I'm saying is that if suppose it's converging toward the uniform distribution, then I'm taking the decision that the graph is connected.
Yes.
So certainly when it is not uniform. So I'm talking actually in terms of, the false positive or when I'm saying it is connected, basically the negative result and it's not connected. So those cases, how will be seeing in this particular context?
Yes. One second, I will address this. So let me write this down that if G is connected, then lambda 2 is strictly smaller than 1. So m raised to t times p minus the uniform distribution. This converges to lambda 2 raised to p that we just saw. Now, what happens if G is not connected? So that also asks, can there be false positives, right, as you asked? So if G is not connected, no matter how many steps we perform this walk, we will never reach the other component. And then the m raised to t vector will have a form like this. So there will be some non-zero values here, but some values will always be zero. So this will be on the component that we start with, let's say S1. And on the S2 component, they will always be zero. So there won't be a false positive because you will not see a non-zero value for something which is not connected. So if you just look at the probability vector after t steps, you will not, you will still see zeros in the component which is not connected to the component that you started with. And see, these are vectors, right? So this m raised to t is also an n-dimensional vector. This uniform distribution is also an n-dimensional vector. Even if one of the entries is zero, the L2 norm cannot be arbitrarily small because this itself contributes a 1 over n. Okay, so the L2 norm difference between them cannot go below 1 over n if the graph is not connected and if some entry remains zero. Right, because the difference of these two 0 versus 1 over n entries will contribute 1 over n to the norm. So the norm will never go the norm of this difference, I mean. M raised to t times p minus 1. I mean minus uniform. This will never go below 1 over n if the graph is connected. If the graph is disconnected.
But do you require, you require matrix here, right? I mean, for this algorithm. So
you require what, sorry?
You require this matrix to be stored, right?
Actually not. This is the analysis that we did. And we said that if we start with the probability vector P and if the graph is connected, then we will keep going closer and closer to the uniform distribution. So we will not actually do this multiplication. All this whole thing guarantees is if I start from a vertex and keep performing the random walk, I am very likely to visit that vertex J. So if I start from vertex I and perform sufficiently many steps of the random walk, and if there is indeed a path from I to J, then I am very likely to visit it as I perform more and more number of steps of this. And actually this lambda 2 is not arbitrary. I will just write down its value, the result that comes about its value, and then it will be clear that we don't need too many steps to guarantee this with a very small error probability. So what we know is that this 1 minus lambda 2 squared is lower bounded by 4d times n square. So if we perform this kind of random walk n square or n cube many times without remembering anything or about the past or about the previous steps in the walk, still it will be a very reasonable probability that we will visit all the vertices, whichever for whichever vertices there is a path from our starting vertex I.
Thanks, it is clear.
Thank you. So this, of course, if G is connected, be regular and undirected. By the way, such a random walk, interestingly, does not converge on directed graphs. So for directed graphs, one can create examples where the random walk will take like exponential time to converge, or the convergence rate will be unacceptably slow. And we also need one self loop on each vertex. So the self loop is just a technicality. B is of course less than or equal to n. So I think I don't have enough time to prove this theorem. But its proof is again some sort of manipulations. It is not a very involved proof.
So this gives you this theorem gives you a bound on the upper bound on the second largest eigenvalue, right?
Yes.
Okay. Thanks.
And that bound is something like 1 over. I mean, 1 over some constant times n raised to 3/2 kind of. I mean, if you take square root here, whatever. If you take lambda 2 square on the other side and take square root, so that what that tells is it is not arbitrarily close to 1, but it is sufficiently away from 1, which guarantees that. Saxena sir talked about the error, and that error one can deduce from this value of lambda 2. So if we perform n square or n cube number of steps of this random walk, with very high probability we are guaranteed to visit every vertex which is connected to our starting vertex. So we don't need the matrix M or anything. We just blindly perform this walk for n square or n cube many steps. And with very, very high success probability or very small error probability, we will visit all the vertices. More number of steps we perform, smaller is our error probability because lambda 2 raised to t will be smaller.
I have a small question. So the G bipartite case is clear. Like when you take bipartite graphs, for sure after certain times, when you are performing this matrix iteration for odd number of times, it will stay in one component. When you are performing for even number of times, it will stay in the other component. So what goes wrong in the proof? Like the proof in the proof, the same proof. If I try to reiterate for bipartite graphs, in which step will we face problem? Like this bound, obtaining this bound. Huh?
So the second eigenvalue, I think, will be minus 1.
So lambda 2 is second smallest eigenvalue of this normalized adjacency, right?
It is second largest eigenvalue of the normalized adjacency matrix. But that is second largest in absolute value. So the largest is 1 And because we are looking at absolute values, this will actually be minus one.
Oh, okay. So then you get this inequality is less than or equal to one. Okay. Two norm of this quantity is less than or equal to one. Yeah.
Which doesn't give us anything.
Information. Okay. Thank you.
So the self loops just try to break that. And even if the graph is bipartite, this thing works if we put a self loop because it no longer remains bipartite.
Okay. Thank you.
So this is all I wanted to say. I think I have also taken up enough time. So if there are more questions, I will address. Otherwise, we can stop and meet in the next talk on Monday.
There's just one sort of small observation. Why is it called the Laplacian? So Laplacian means second derivative, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So I think what this no one actually says, but it should probably be said in the beginning that it is a Laplacian because it is fx minus fx minus h minus fx plus h. So on the circle graph, if you take a circle graph on Zn, okay, this is the Laplacian. Fx minus fx minus h minus fx plus h. So, I mean, nobody really mentions this, but the question is, why do you call it Laplacian? Laplacian is second derivative. And then why are you talking about second derivative? And why is this D minus A? So it is D minus A because in the case of the circle, okay, circle graph, it is Fn, what is it? Fk, 2fk minus fk minus 1 minus fk plus 1. Okay.
I see.
That is why D minus A is called the Laplacian. I mean, people normally don't mention this, but it's just a general statement. And the other thing is also something which I don't quite understand is that, you know, the first, you see, what is important in all this is that the first spectral gap, normalizing the first thing to be zero, and then you have lambda two or whatever it is, and that is the gap.
Yes.
So the statement is that the first spectral gap is important geometrically because it tells you how fast the graph is expanding. At every point, it is expanding in a certain, for every set, not just every point, for every set, it is expanding at a certain rate. So that the first spectral gap tells you that. Obviously, there should be something about the second spectral gap. Similarly with the third spectral gap. And there seem to be some kind of partial things one can say. You understand what I mean by the second spectral gap. Second bracket, the first spectral gap is lambda 2 minus lambda 1. So now I'm talking about lambda 3 minus lambda 2.
Yes.
So lambda 3 minus lambda 2 should also control some kind of connectivity. Okay. And I don't really know what. So there, I think I've seen some things along this line, but not very much. And but the what should one say? Philosophy behind this is that it's not just the eigenvalues that are important, but what is equally important is the gaps between the eigenvalues. Yes. So the gaps control a great deal of properties about that graph. And it will be very nice if one can say something about the second spectral graph, lambda 3 yes. minus lambda 2.
There is something about the higher... something called higher order Chigger inequality. So the yes. one I wrote is for lambda 2, but there is some higher order Chigger's inequality.
No, but what is the geometric thing it represents is the question. Okay, not just the inequality, but lambda 2 minus lambda 1 represents something. It is how fast every set grows in ratio.
Yes.
And therefore, in the same way, lambda 3 minus lambda 2 must also represent how fast or slow something is changing. Question is, what is that thing? Okay. And it's actually a very interesting question that what would correspond to that minimizing over the edge set, things that go out of the set divided by the measure of the set and minimize that. And that is related to the first spectrum.
So all I know is the largest eigenvector or maybe multiple of them, they are useful in coloring because they try to keep vertices, I mean neighboring vertices, as far apart as possible. So they are somehow useful in coloring the graph. But
this is a general comment that just as the first spectral gap is important, so should the second spectral gap. And obviously there are relations also with chemistry, and you have you have energy levels of something, and then you're worried about the gap in the energy levels, and that should have something to do with eigenvalues or whatever you're talking about. Well, it should have something to do with some kind of thing. Anyway, this is just a general comment, and I think next time you're going to talk about large expanders. So this tomorrow, are you starting it tomorrow about expanders?
Monday,
yeah. On Monday, you'll be telling us about expanders.
To construct graphs which have a good edge expansion. In fact, I will only talk about graphs which have a small enough second eigenvalue.
Yeah, okay. Okay.
So here there are actually a lot of connections. Like there is one whole book on random walks and electric networks. And these are very nice reads. They are not difficult to do. And they relate this whole thing to resistance and whatever things in the electrical network. That is one nice reference that I.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you all for attending.